Welcome to Interviews with Architects, sponsored by VM Zinc and hosted by Dan Nicely. In this episode, we'll be talking with Bernard Jin.
Perimeter is a theoretical institute, and it's an addition. Your project is an addition to an existing building by
Associated Perron,
also a Canadian firm. Mm-hmm. And their approach was very, I don't know if I dare say this, but almost geometric, where they're playing with the push and pull of the program elements on the backside along the river, and very linear, but still a pretty amazing sense of detail in the atrium and how they detailed some of the materiality of things coming together. Mm-hmm. And then Teeple Architects comes along, does this addition, also in zinc, thank you. And it's much more sculptural, and then you have this play of thought, in the sense that you've set up these spaces for people to converse, to think, to talk, mm-hmm. to debate, and then also to learn and to share and to teach, if I'm yeah. hitting this correctly. Yeah. You've also carried the materiality of the building from the outside in. So we see a lot of the zinc being used on the inside. We see the same kind of basic fundamental formal qualities mm-hmm. transferring through. Tell us a little bit about that project.
Well, first of all, I think the initial project for Perimeter Institute by Saucier Perrot was just such a major accomplishment in representing architecture in Canada and to the world, because the form was incredibly complex and yet so simple in its kind of acknowledgement of its resolution. It's these amazing qualities of space that are at some moment quite definitive, and yet slipping and sliding, and the penetration of space going north-south and east-west and vertically and diagonally, and just the circuits through the public areas are just an incredible, thoughtful collection of volumes that are experienced as space. We felt that they had always represented Canada in such an elevated level of ability. We felt that not only architects that we knew, architects that we would love to work with, but also architects to be represented well with a complementary building. And it was difficult only in trying to build on such a tight site afterwards that we realized we could be very respectful of their work by engaging it as closely as possible, and that in that density, we could also release the kind of the connection between the spaces as being something that would be thoughtful and practical, that you would extend one of their hallways and to right into our atrium. Two kind of responses that are practical, spatial, begin to demarcate the understanding that the other building has its own significance, its own expression, and we would somehow pick the practical terms of making a building more useful by connecting them rather than separating. Even though there was the problem solving of building on a tight site, there was the optimizing of energy use. And these are different qualities than the initial qualities that the firm Saucier Perrot had to solve initially. Why not engage, an award-winning project? The approach that Stephen Teeple had on the site was really to ensure that the project could be that it could respond thoughtfully to the restrictions. Site area, number of levels, and maintain certain views. Theoretical research that was sometimes independent, we began to see an opportunity for them. Well, they presented that opportunity to us, that teaching was going to become a future component of their institute. So the relationship between the researcher and the young graduates in research were to encourage dialogue and interaction, and that was a primary importance, yet maintaining acoustic separation and quiet research was still an ambition that had to be met. The new director that had been brought to Perimeter from Cambridge, England, who he is Neil Turok, and he's known to be a cosmologist, he calls himself, but I think the ability to reflect on the beginnings of the universe and to do that research with Stephen Hawking is probably where he engaged in another manner, which is the study of so many different realms of theoretical physics that in one institute they could then see further enrichment by bringing more people together in different spaces that could encourage that interaction. His vision to do that came with a vision that people must be in dialogue and have the chance encounters that would allow them to discuss superstring theory with cosmology and to discuss them in realms of quantum mechanics and now, you know, and dark matter, and now with the discoveries of particle physics and the Hadron Collider, they're looking at mapping the behavior of particles as a way of proving theories. And so now they're embarking on a whole realm of the universe that should be represented somehow in an environment where they could not only carry out those day-to-day tasks of being in quiet research, being in dialogue, needing meters and meters and meters of blackboard to express in theoretical terms what they believe to be a direction in physics. Wanting to do a building that allowed researchers to engage in each other meant that the hallways were wider at one end than another, and that meant that they would always be physically engaged with where the researchers were, because the wider hallways meant that they had good views of whether or not they were in office or out of office. It meant that we could narrow corridors to loud areas and basically restrict the sound passage from more public areas to the research areas. And so began the shaping of the building. The arrangement of the program permitted us to move from the very public and more engaging atrium to the more quiet. So the further you moved away from the atrium, the closer you would get to views of the lake, and the quieter the areas would become. Having to separate offices and provide natural light meant two things. One, which the form of the building began to basically evolve as almost like a letter E, right? And the two spaces, the two courtyards, we were then able to bring a lot of natural light into all the offices, and we could separate offices so that we could keep the acoustic levels monitored and separated. It also meant that the approach from the noisy to the quiet was always through these corridors or bridges. Mm-hmm. And the bridges offered opportunities of views, lots of natural light, and it allowed us to place more blackboards in, you know, the entrances to the quiet areas, as opposed to putting the blackboards adjacent to somebody's office, and where you'd want some quiet and not someone, you know, tapping away on the blackboard while you're trying to figure out the last 6 hours of concentrated mathematical right. theory and formula that you were not to be, you know, disturbed.
Yeah, I was really impressed by that. I mean, I was really impressed by the level of thought that went into the space. In other words, that you had these moments of, and I don't know if you were involved in the furnishing selection as well, but these incredible well-furnished spaces where you can sit and just contemplate, and then at the next moment, you know, but still separated, of incredible activity.
When Steve thought of it, you know, this capacity to have pathways that are multiple, that there's choices, and that you could find yourself walking through pathways. And the researchers now, I think one of the superstring theorists, he says, well, I have my favorite route. and my favorite route always takes me by this one courtyard where you have the rock garden, right? And he says, I always look at the rock garden first, and then I engage in the full length of the atrium spine. And I thought that was just quite a nice compliment.
Very nice.
That he would lift his eyes from the research, and he would look to the building to help him feel rested. And so we tapered the building. So the building goes from 3 floors and tapers itself to 2 to maintain a view. And suddenly the components of shaping and sculpting space, so the tapering, the shaping of 3 floors to 2, actually guided us to reinterpret how the window patterns would represent that taper. So you would see the gold glass, you would see the zinc, and you would imagine that these research, these orbiting offices, you know, these little research pods would then turn into long lines where individuality becomes a collective sharing and teaching. I think Steve says it best that it's, you know, a project of a lifetime and a unique project that they gave us. What I found interesting was that Stephen Hawking wanted to know what it was in physics that we thought was influencing us. And I hadn't known this until long after the interview, long after the talk with him, and long after the discussion. But we then learned that he wanted to hear what inspired us about architecture that came from physics. And he was spot on, and maybe it was through the last 4 years that we had developed our understanding of physics a little bit more, at least from a casual observer's side. And our development of the stair, our development of the building form, and some of the angular planes were influenced a great deal from the idea that a physicist, you know, starts from one idea or the kernel in a direction of research that then suddenly expands and becomes this multiple level of research, that they go from quantum mechanics to dark matter to cosmology, and then it disappears, that it resolves itself. And you would see that in even the way that we produced the shape of the feature wall, which is these cubes done by Christie Panels, and it starts from a line, and the line becomes this wide, exploding, broad spectrum of images that they project from rear projection box technology. And then it ends again as a visual 3-box media screen that faces the entrance. So we were pretty happy that even the shaping of new elements, you know, signage, communication items,
follows
the same path, that the physicist is this person who is dedicated to an intense amount of research, and somehow it can become, you know, part of the oneness of their institute, that, you know, they're an integral whole, you know, they're among different facets of research, and they're all proud to be together.
I really appreciate your time. In a nod to our sponsors, I'd like to encourage you to enter the ArcSync Trophy competition coming up again in another year and a half with this building. It's incredible. It's juried by architects, not by Zinc people. Mm-hmm. And thank you for using our products. We appreciate that. But thank you more for your time today.
Pleasure. It's something that we enjoy very much.
Sure. It's
communicating of our ideas is something that we love those opportunities.
Thank you for listening to Interviews with Architects. To watch the video version of today's podcast and others, please visit our YouTube channel, VM Zinc Presents. And for more information about VM Zinc products, visit our website at www.vmzinc-usa.com.